call the council meeting to order. Can we have a motion to amend or accept the agenda? And Gary has a, Counselor Bodden and Counselor McGowan?
Just wanted to mention that we need to add the interim tax bylaw to the bylaw section of the agenda. The interim tax bylaw was included in your package, but it's not listed on the agenda, so that should come under the bylaws section. Also wanted to shift the department report presentations and the reports from the Director of Recreation and Facilities will go after the administrator's report.
Those in favor of the amended agenda? Opposed? Carried. Declaration of pecuniary interest.
Chair, I have an item under item number one, new business. Second, we consider.
No others? Okay. Under Reeves' report, Reed Vincent had a meeting in Toronto this afternoon, and we expect him here a little bit later. But just in, under the Reeves report, I'd like to commend the municipal staff for the work they're doing on snow removal and keeping our roads open and clean. I think with the amount of snow that we've had and the continuous amount of snow we've had, they've done a phenomenal job and should be commended. For the reading of the minutes of the previous meeting, moved by Councillor Campbell, seconded by Councillor Vaughton. Those in favor? Carried. And also that council hereby adopts the minutes of the Planning Advisory Committee meeting held February 3rd, 2014. We have a motion for that. Councillor Bailey, seconded by Councillor Campbell. And the regular council meeting held February 3rd as printed and circulated. I guess we did that one. So then we go to the third item. The council hereby adopts the minutes of the special council meeting held February 10th, as printed and circulated. Mm-hmm. Councillor Vaughton, seconded by Councillor Bailey. Those in favor? Carried. And number four, the council hereby adopts the minutes of the special council meeting held February 12th, as printed and circulated. Councillor Campbell, Councillor Bailey, all in favor? Opposed? Carried. And then for we move to deputations and invited guests. Connie will introduce the first one, the Alabama Writers and Readers Festival delegation.
Super, and again, I'm Connie Goodall. I'd like to welcome back the Allison Monroe Writers and Readers Festival. They have been here before, and they're great to do an update for us. Representing them tonight is Jody Jerome, Susan Chapman, and speaking, as always, we always do this tour, is Karen Stewart, and we appreciate her for it. So I'll be the clicker again. Tonight to provide a brief update of the Alice Monroe Writers and Readers Festival
2014 Festival. We continue to enjoy heightened awareness of our community and festival through the incomparable success of Alice Monroe. And in 2014, our festival hopes to leverage that profile to provide expanded and new opportunities for readers and writers. Through the Alice Monroe Writers and Readers Festival, we turn reading into a community experience, bringing people together to share thoughts, explore ideas, and witness spirited conversations. Over the past 2 years, we have enriched our imaginations and the culture of our community and have inspired many by creating a forum for writers to connect with readers. By offering a vibrant exchange of ideas and conversations, we're growing the Alice Monroe Writers and Readers Festival to bring attention to North Huron as a culturally interesting and stimulating place to visit, to live, and to play. This festival is a celebration of story. For 3 days in September, this celebration takes place with unique activities in North Huron and continues throughout the year with two special series and an annual short story competition. The 2014 Short Story Competition has been launched, and in fact, the first story has been received from Washington. Last year, we enjoyed a doubling of entries, and we hope to grow this competition even more this year. Reading aloud in Huron was the breakout surprise of last year's festival. Events where writers of poetry, nonfiction, comedy, and even music enjoyed an appreciative audience during an open mic at the CKNX studio. This spring, we're offering this series at three sites, including Blythe, Brussels, and Bayfield. It will be scheduled during the festival on Saturday, September 27th as well. And this summer, we're working on an Alice Story Series, hosting Blythe Festival actor simply reading one of Alice Monroe's short stories. This is meant to be a casual opportunity to simply enjoy a delightful story by our Nobel Prize-winning laureate. These series events are supported by a partnership with the Blythe Center for the Arts. Artistic Director Mary DeVries is the emcee for the reading aloud events. During the afternoon, we're offering ample opportunity for festival guests to enjoy the Alice Monroe Collection at the North Huron Museum and spend a few quiet moments of reflection in the Alice Monroe Literary Garden. Volunteer docents at the museum will be available to engage festival goers with intimate knowledge of our community and our celebrity VIP. These are the events that we are planning this year. A couple of new events are the Book Lovers Bash on the Friday night, the Literature and Landscape, that's an art gallery exhibit at the Baiton Gallery, and the Baiton Gallery Group are coordinating that on our behalf. We'll also be rerunning the Writers Workshop. On Reading Monroe is an event on Saturday morning that brings together a panel that discusses Alice's writing, reading aloud, I spoke about, at the CKNX studio, and an Alice Country Guided Walking Tour, a Sunday brunch, and then the Saturday Evening Gala Appreciating Alice will once again put a spotlight on our writers as the finalists in both the adult and youth short story competition come together to share excerpts of their entry and learn their standing during the awards ceremony. A keynote address will be presented by a celebrated Canadian author who will, hopefully, further inspire our writers and those who appreciate the written word. An opportunity to introduce our supporting sponsors and presenting partners, as well as a harvest dinner and a silent auction are all included on the evening's agenda. The steering committee is committed to finding ways to encourage continued growth of the annual Alice Monroe Writers and Readers Festival, gaining awareness and a place among Canada's important literary celebrations and authors' community, contributing to the quality and diversity of the community life in North Huron and the county of Huron, and providing opportunities for economic activity and cultural partnerships. We hope that the municipality of North Huron will continue to invest in its community through its support of the Alice Monroe Writers and Readers Festival. In-kind support includes access to venues and human resources, the Blythe Memorial Community Hall for two events, the North Huron Museum for meetings, the Alice Monroe, access to the Alice Monroe Connection and the Reading Garden. The Community Development Coordinator, we're very happy to have Connie at our table and supporting our work. North Huron Summer Student, who's integral to recording all of the short story entries, which is a humongous task we find out, and hosting of the Alice Monroe Festival.ca website. As mentioned in our report last fall in respect to a financial contribution, our committee is requesting an increase to $3,000 in financial support for the 2014 Alice Munro Writers and Readers Festival. These funds will be used directly to increase promotional opportunities and build awareness of the festival. Further, an application to the Ministry of Training, Universities, and Colleges will bring expertise of a consultant to determine future directions of the community with respect to honoring Alice Munro and her body of work. Depending on recommendations outlined in the consultant's report, we may seek to incorporate as an independent not-for-profit to enable our access to grants in future years. We trust you will continue your support of these important cultural events. I love that last little photo. It was one of our young youth writers last year who got to meet our keynote speaker, Alice Wiesentroyser. That was a really special moment for both of them. Ideas create books, but people create the festival. The Writers Festival brings people of all backgrounds together, writers, youth, adults, and many volunteers, all of whom love to read. They also love what reading represents, the stirring of ideas, sparks of recognition, and the realization that we are all connected. I thank you for your time and consideration. Together, we will create a festival celebrating the works and creativity of Alice Munro for today, tomorrow, and the future. Together, we will achieve success developing an iconic and important literary festival that centers on the landscape and literary opportunities in Alice Munro Country, North Huron, and Huron County. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Are there any questions for Karen?
Just a question for our Director of Finance. I just wanted to confirm that the requested amount has been included in the 2014 budget.
Yes, we increased that from 2,500 to 3,000, and that was included in our budget already.
Great. Thank you very much, Karen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Gary, would you introduce our next speaker, please?
Okay, thank you, Deputy Rick. Did you want to be
I can do that, sure. So I'm going to give a little background as well. Okay, I'm very pleased to introduce Susan Underwood. And Susan Underwood is part of the Building Bridges campaign, which is an exciting good news story for our community. I know she has a number of handouts, so if you want to hand those out, perfect. And I will just give everybody a bit of
understanding of what that's all right.
Susan is here to do and ask for today. So she's going to tell you all about the project, all about the fundraising campaign. I just want to be really clear up front because this question will be in everybody's mind. Susan and her group is not here to ask for funding tonight. They're asking that you support a Trillium application, of which we would be a collaborative application with the township being the lead on the application for a grant to work towards meeting their fundraising goal on this application. So that is what we're asking for tonight from council. And I would like to turn it over to Susan to explain the project and the exciting things that they have planned with the Building Bridges campaign. Yeah, we're right ahead.
Okay.
Yeah, wherever you want to go.
Evening, Deputy Reed, councillors, guests. I'm Susan Underwood, and currently I'm the chair of the Building Bridges to Your Future fundraising campaign for Women Area. With such a wonderful community, there's always additional needs, and through a group of very hardworking volunteers, there's been a few needs as far as our community areas that we've identified, and we're working very hard to try and see that they come to fruition. You'll notice on the brochure on the front, you'll see three links. And those links we refer to as the three links of the project. The overall project is a very lofty goal of $760,000. It includes Maitland River Elementary School with the new playground equipment, their different music program, and their sensory room. The other project is the area between the two schools, which we're calling our learning bridges. It's going to be an arboretum. It's an outdoor ed center used for Cubs, Scouts, another soccer field, planting trees, accessible gardens for seniors, and it will also link into our current walking trail, and will add another 45 minutes to the current walking trail in Wingham, and actually completes the circuit. The third part, and this is where we come into the Trillium Grant, is the sports fields at the F.E. Medill School. Currently, the sports fields are in terrible disrepair. The upper field is very small, and one of the things we propose is making it actually a proper sized field. The second part in that project is resurfacing the current, what most of us know as the lower field, resurfacing the track and doing some much needed drainage work, and then the addition of lights. The lights bring so much to the community. We have a lot of seniors walking groups that use that track, and quite honestly, it's not safe right now. And with the resurfacing and the lights, I think we'll see a much greater use. And also getting from the upper field to the lower field, it's not very accessible. If anybody knows how steep that hill is, it's treacherous. And that's one of the things we'd like to do to help. You know, those grandparents go and see their kids play soccer. And soccer is a huge part of this project. Minor Soccer has already made a significant donation towards the project. And with the loss of the fields at Turnberry, Minor Soccer is in desperate need of new playing fields. The track and field club, again, is in real need of some additional space and improvements for the kids to excel. So with the numbers in front of you, our proposal is to do this project, and the Building Bridges campaign is over 3 years. Break it down over the 3 year period. And the Trillium application we'd like to work on is over 2 years. So we can apply for $75,000 each year to help us towards our goals. You may have some other questions as far as other funding. We have several other grants underway at this time. Libro, TD. We've already received the Toyota Evergreen grant, so that was very positive. And what else have we got on the go here? The Lions are actually working as a collaborative group and looking at making a significant donation there. They haven't decided which area they're donating to yet, but to date we've already raised over $70,000 towards the project. And there's some other ones like Friends of the Environment for TV, the Metro, and Let Them Be Friends are the ones we're waiting to hear back on right now. We're relatively early in our fundraising, and so our $70,000 that we have so far is encouraging, and we have not even begun the private donations for approaching corporations. So, any questions?
I guess if there's any questions about the project, Susan's here to answer it. So how Trillium works is the school is ineligible to apply for Trillium, nor is a group that's not, basically the municipality is a group that's eligible to apply for a Trillium grant. And I've been attending these meetings about this project for the past year to keep in tune with the field development and the learning grounds. And it's a great opportunity for our community because really with our joint use agreement with the school board, after 4:30 or after 4 o'clock, those grounds are turned over to us. And we have lots of programs that go on inside the schools as well as outside the schools. So although these fields are on school property, they're very much a community resource. And we're excited about the opportunity to have an additional field for our soccer, which I remember
The president of soccer was here, Fred Valdez, and he explained that actually soccer is our largest minor sport in Wingham right now, and they continue to grow each year. So the request is to have a council support to a motion that would allow us to do a collaborative application on behalf of the township as the lead applicant.
Are there any questions?
Are you involved with Campton Wharf, I think it is, the real estate company?
Yes, they're very much part of our group, and they've asked to be sort of the corporate sponsor, and they're doing challenges to other businesses in the area, and we have, you know, we're slowly working. We haven't done a real hit the ground running campaign yet, but trying to get more of our ducks in a row before we go out and challenge the community. But we have received, yes, monies from them and monies from some of the other businesses in the area, including the Business Improvement Association.
I make that motion.
Moved by Councillor McGowan, seconded by Councillor Bailey. Any discussion? Those in favor? Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you very much.
Does anyone else want a copy of these? Can you grab one and hand them down?
Okay.
That'd be great.
Okay, thanks.
Any business arising from the previous meetings? Yes. Okay. Moving on, for department reports, health and safety, the minutes from the January 30th meeting are included. Any questions? Okay. Director of Corporate Services, Deputy Clerk, Council meeting attendance for February 2014. I guess you want that this evening?
I think there's one more meeting this week on Thursday evening, and then after that, if you could get them into me, that would be great.
Okay. Going on to administration, the Columbus Center Agreement Renewal. Gary?
Okay, thank you, Deputy Reeve. I put together a staff report regarding our renewal of the agreement with the Knights of Columbus. The agreement, which is part of the bylaw section in your agenda, is essentially the same agreement as before. Instead of a 3-year term, we're proposing a 5-year term. The Knights will continue to pay the same pledge amount on a yearly basis, particularly or specifically at $12,500. They will continue to make a contribution towards utilities, and just given the increase in cost of utilities that we're all experiencing, the Knights agreed to increase their annual contribution from $15,000 a year to $17,000 a year for utilities. And they also pay a percentage of the annual operating deficit of the facility. I think it's noteworthy that we've had an agreement with the Knights since the facility was constructed. That agreement has been in place since November 2000. At that time, the Knights of Columbus made a very generous pledge towards the facility of $550,000. And since that time, the Knights have honored that commitment, and they make their payments, and they've been a good partner with the township. In fact, to date, the Knights have paid $192,000 towards their pledge, leaving a balance of about $257,000. And as I said before, they contribute towards utilities as well as a percentage of the operating deficit. Our strategic plan talks about the importance of community partnerships. Our strat plan also talks about the importance of volunteerism, and the Knights are an important part of this community, and they've honored their pledge commitment to the township, and they will continue to do so in the years ahead as part of this new agreement. It's a 5-year agreement, and over the last couple of months, I've worked closely with Bill McGrath and Jack Hodgkiss from the Knights, and I'm pleased that Bill and Jack are here tonight. And this is my staff report to support the draft agreement, which is under the bylaw section of your agenda. I'd be pleased to answer any questions that you have. Perhaps Bill and Jack would also be available to answer questions you may have about the agreement.
Are there any questions? Comments? Seeing none. Oh, Councillor Bodnar.
I was just wondering, Bill, if you have any comments about how the site has progressed over the past few years and what changes have taken place in terms of operations and success factors.
We've had a lot of changes in operations. We've gone through a couple of managers. One thing we've kept over those years is a fantastic volunteer basis, being members of the Knights of Columbus, but also being a lot of members of the community. And not just Wingham, Belgrave, Blythe, that whole area, we have a lot of support. We are presently working on a report for council in conjunction with the clerk and hopefully the treasurer. And I think all of us will be pleasantly surprised at the amount of dollars that have been derived through the complex by us keeping it that way as volunteers, and we will have a total dollars for a breakdown to the public. Sorry, I have a bit of a cough and a cold, so one of the questions that kept coming up over the years was, why don't the public know the amount of dollars that the township and the Knights have put in it? And we hope to have that report ready for you within the next 6 weeks. I think it's just about all done, and the report will be there. And like I say, I think you will see through the generosity of all groups involved, it saved the taxpayers a lot of dollars. We've had a great relationship over the last number of years now with the Recreation Department, with the Parks Department, with Town Council. And I think we had rough roads in the beginning, as everybody knows, and particularly over the last couple of years, those have kind of smoothed out and things seem to be running quite smoothly. There has been a lot of changes, as you know, involving the Liquor Control Board, the people that have to be involved. We've had a great relationship with the Police Department. And I think now over the years of working all these things out, we now have learned from it, and I think for the next, hopefully, 5 years, that I'll be involved there, and Jack and the rest of the board, things should run very smoothly. Every year we'd love to see a lot more weddings, we'd love to see a lot more stag and does, but we also have times where getting the volunteers just to do the amount of work that needs to be done is hard to come up with. So. Thanks. Overall, the complex looks great.
Thank you.
Councillor McGowan.
Through you, Deputy Reeve. I just wondered, Bill, will part of that report be the amount of monies that have flowed back into the community? Because I think that's an Definitely. Important part of the puzzle as well.
Well, again, we've tried to, I guess before we come out and give statements, Archie, of the amount of dollars, we want to make sure that there's a lot of different things that have to be involved in here. There's, people say, well, you got heat, you got hydro, you got water, you got sewage. All of these things are going back in here. And I think what we all want to make sure is that when we give that report, it's given in a manner that it's not done by the Knights, it's not done by council, but it's done together. And Gary has done a lot of work.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
Just a friendly little word.
Okay, Bill, here's where you earn your money.
Well, I remember he did that over at the ice cream shop and they got the price. Anyway,
Oh, now we got two.
Tash just wanted to get it married.
Is that Pat's wallet, Denny? Hold on to it.
Don't take my picture, Denny.
It's just a bat.
I know, I just could get it out the door, that'd be good.
If you turn the light on.
So Kelly, you just sit there for a while. I know. There we go. Oh, now it's our tea!
It's not a mop.
It's still fine.
I can see in the dark.
It's not a mop.
I don't know, you're not.
I know, my coat's.
She's close.
Connie, turn on the light so I can see him.
Where's Donna?
Almost.
Oh, there we go. Get him, Steve. Your job, jump on him.
No, no, just keep your thing open.
Yeah, we don't have the animal specialist.
Open the door.
Here, let's close this door, can I move this up, and we'll go play with him out here. If we can get him out.
Oh, no.
I know, but I want to make his thing dirty. Is it okay if we get here? It's right there.
Well, you see, we meshed off the bell pretty, so they gotta go somewhere.
I don't think so.
Nope.
We will note that there was no bats here until you arrived.
Just leave it for later.
No.
We never have bats.
Is that always a center thing?
Okay.
Okay, moving on. Are there any more questions for Joey Jack and the next Columbus? Councilor Bailey.
I have a question. I just want to say it's been a pleasure working with Columbus through the last few years. It's good to see that some of our volunteer groups are surviving. We've lost a few through the years. So I'm sure I speak for all of Pals when I say we will work with you and good luck in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And seeing no more questions, we'll move on. Item number two under administration, restricted acts after nomination date. You want to speak to that?
Okay, thank you, Deputy Reeve. I had a couple inquiries from staff and council regarding lame duck status, and just wanted to spell out information from the Municipal Act, specifically section 275, which deals with lame duck, and it really only takes effect after nomination day, which this year is September 12th. But I think council and staff need to be mindful of the restrictions after nomination day, as council is going about decision making and taking actions and so on. So there's really no action required. I don't need any sort of motion, but I think it's my responsibility to make council aware of restricted acts after nomination day. And as I said, I've outlined the four restricted acts that would take effect after nomination day on September 12th. But I think it's important to note that between now and September 12th, that it's business as usual, and council has the authority to make decisions and make expenditures as you always have. But the game changes after September 12th. Any questions on that?
Seeing none, moving on to closed meeting investigator.
Okay, thank you, Kevin. We had, the township had a closed meeting investigator on retainer, specifically JGM Consulting. Mr. Maddox retired, and so the municipality doesn't have an investigator on retainer. We are not mandated by the Municipal Act to have an investigator. If municipality and a council do not appoint an investigator, it just defaults to the Ontario Ombudsman. That is an option of council. Another option would be to appoint an investigator who would be on retainer. And I've made a recommendation that that we appoint Local Authority Services Limited to be the municipality's investigator. They have a relationship with a third-party company titled Amberley Gavel Limited. LAS, Local Authority Services Limited, is a subsidiary of the Association of Municipalities of Ontario. It's noteworthy that LAS and their relationship with Amberley Gavel have 134 Ontario municipalities as their investigator. And certainly Amberley Gavel have worked very closely with municipalities on closed meeting investigations. There are other lawyers and other companies in Ontario that provide that service. My recommendation would be to go with LAS and Amberley Gavel, but I defer to council.
Are there any questions?
I have a question. If we were to go to this source and somebody was to call the ombudsman, who would handle it then? The ombudsman? The Ontario ombudsman? Or would he just refer it over to the person that we hired?
As it stands right now, if we were to receive
per company key.
If we were to receive a complaint related to a closed meeting, that complaint is filed with the clerk, and the clerk would be obligated to refer that to the ombudsman at the present time, because we do not have an investigator on retainer.
So all complaints go to the union?
Just for processing. And so the clerk would forward that complaint to the ombudsman, or if we had somebody on retainer, the clerk would forward that complaint to Amberley Gavel or whoever council appoints, if you choose for council. I don't do those investigations.
No, I just wonder, does somebody call the ombudsman directly and then they get back to you, but you're telling me that everything has to go through you first? I would presume that would be whoever we hire or the ombudsman, and then they get back to you to say, we would like this information.
Councillor Bodden?
I have mixed feelings about our choice. I am very impressed with the ombudsman. I followed their work in a lot of areas. I know that they were very helpful to us when we were fighting the school closure issue. They really helped us formulate our complaint to the ministry. It didn't work out the way we wanted to, but they were very, very helpful. I'm a little bit concerned about the kinds of pony shows that go on when there is a problem. Now, in a way, we shouldn't be worried about this because we've never had any complaints, and I don't anticipate we'll have any in the future because we are so very careful about how we use the closed meetings and so on. So I would be comfortable with going with LAS as our choice. I know one of the gentlemen who formed organization, I forgot the name, Fred Dean. He's very, very active, a very insightful lawyer, and straight as a die in terms of he's not going to show any favoritism. If a municipality is acting improperly in closed meetings, he will find out about it and he'll deal with it. So it's not a matter of shopping around for somebody that's going to give us an easy ride. So I'm leaning towards recommending LAS as the special closed meeting investigator, and I also want to suggest that we consider whether or not we're going to have a fee involved in submitting a complaint. I guess I'll make a motion that we go with LAS.
Okay, moved by Councillor Botten, we go with LAS. Is there a seconder? Councillor Campbell? Discussion? Counselor Bailey?
Just to go back, Brock, to what you said a little earlier about the cost of it. So all of a sudden, we're sitting in a retainer fee, but is it going to cost us $100 an hour for him to do the work as compared to whatever the office charges?
Counselor Vaughn?
The cost, and we don't know what the fee will be at this point, but the fee with the previous one was, I think, $339 a year. That's the retainer. Now, if there's a complaint, then there's a fee structure that this organization will have. And that's one thing that we would not have if we were using the ombudsman. It's a free service. But I doubt that we're going to have any issues that are going to involve that kind of expenditure.
So could I just suggest, since there's no hurry?
Yes, go ahead.
Could I just suggest, since there's no hurry, if we find out what that fee is?
Gary?
Gary's got it.
Oh, well, Gary, let me see. Just wanted to confirm that the LAS retainer fee is $330 per year. And if required, the cost of the required investigation is $225 per hour. And that's the fee that's charged by the third party, Amberly Gavel Limited. But the retainer is $330 per year, which, as Councilor Bodden said, is consistent with what we're paying for.
Okay, any further discussion? Call the motion then. Those in favor? Opposed? Motion is carried. Okay, moving on, Director of Recreation and Facilities for the airport discussion.
Yeah, I just have a couple things to put up on the projector on the computer. Connie, can I get you to turn the projector on while I'm taking this over? Package. There's a report for Council's background information regarding the airport. It was brought forward at the January 13th Council meeting, a proposal regarding the farmland that surrounds the airport, and asked for staff to clarify information on the lands and needs at the airport. So I thought first what I would try and do is explain the property. So the yellow line outlines the entire property. Going to give you some landmarks so you know where you are. This is Amberly Road, Wingham's over here, and this is the runway, and this entire outline of yellow is the property that we call the Wingham Airport. If you can't see that, that's just depicting in different colors the different, according to the town, official plan. So here is, there we go. This is what is designated for airport use. There's natural environment in this area, and then agricultural land in the other areas. So total area is 448.88 acres. Airport lands make up 74.81 acres. The natural environment is 136.58 acres. Industrial is 3 acres. So if you're asking what that is, that's the little strip right next to West Cast Industries,
which is on our property to the side of our driveway. So that would be that area that they're talking about. And agricultural is 234.49 acres. So what I'm going to do is blow up this area here. This is the airport lands with the runway, and show you. This is giving you some understanding of the way that the airspace works at the airport. So if this is the runway here, so nothing can obviously impede the runway. And then these lines that move outside are called the transition surface of the runway. And they go from 0 to 45 meters at the far edge. And each line represents 5 meters higher that you can put something on the ground up to that height. And then this area here, just quickly, that is the takeoff and landing is what I call it. There's another official line. Words for those, but it's like a funnel that works at either end of the runway to allow aircraft in and out. So it shows you exactly what area needs to be specifically protected right near the runway for height requirements. So that was showing you it when it is the airport as it exists today. There is long-term plan for a crosswind runway, which would be looking like this. So it's difficult to see on this diagram here, but just like there were lines that went out this way, there are lines that come out this way from this runway and another trajectory out each end of each runway. They've also accounted for a future lengthening of the runway should that ever be something that the township requires, not knowing what kinds of aircrafts would need to come in and out. So this future plan looks something like this when you look at the whole map. So this is the obstacle limitation surface. It is a 4 kilometer radius around the runway of the airport, of which nothing greater than 45 meters in height can be built. In our area, that's really telecommunication towers and wind turbines. Currently, nothing impedes that airspace now within the town of Wingham and the edge of Blue Vale. And so you can see how far we control, or we want to be able to control, the height of obstacles around our runway. And then these are the smaller areas, which I was showing you in the previous diagram. So that's just a bit of information about when we think of airport, we have to think more than just of the ground. We have to think of everything that goes up and on going around the airport. In my report, I just wanted to lay that out. If there's any questions, I'm more than happy to try and explain all of that. Right now, it's designated as one lot. So selling off portions would require that we investigate how that could be done, creating lots to transition ownership. And figuring out how that could be done. I have had some initial conversations to understand that process, but further investigation would have to be done. For airport management, selling off lots may create challenges because airport development plans and possible expansion and safety standards, which are set out by Transport Canada and NAV Canada, are always uncertain and new things come up. As I said, different kinds of aircrafts, different kinds of things coming in and out. So in order for us to determine if there are surplus lands, we really need a detailed analysis to depict what lands we need to keep in order to control the airport management and what could be surplus, if any. Right now, the operating budget for 2014 is indicating a slight profit at the airport. If we were to sell off the farmland, we get annually a revenue of $59,800 from that revenue, and that would lead us into a deficit if we didn't have that revenue, which helps support the operations at the airport. It was all purchases one lot with the intention that that farmland would offset the expenses in order for it to be not as difficult for the taxpayers to maintain the airport. There's natural environment as I was demonstrating there, all the logging area. And it was recently, or last logged in 2005 and 2006, and a revenue of $200,000 was achieved at that time. At last assessment of the land, it should be ready for logging close to 2016, and of course the revenue will depend on commodity prices, but that's a source of revenue for the municipality. The crosswind runway, although it doesn't exist today, pilots today talk about the crosswinds that exist in Wingham, and we had a lot of wind lately, and you can imagine trying to land and take off in strong crosswinds, which is, of course, the major direction that the winds travel in this area. So a crosswind runway, one that goes the other way, would help with smaller and lighter aircraft and takeoff and landings. I've sort of explained a little bit about airspace protection, and you know, there's really no surplus land when it talks about protecting our airspace, because as soon as we give up any control, then somebody can put up an obstruction that could impede future development or growth at the airport. And in fact, even in our tenant agreement for the farmland, there's certain crops that can't be grown because their height exceeds the limit that we can have in our airspace. In my report is a summary of the taxes. There are taxes, there are three privately owned hangars, and those are taxed. The taxes are collected by North Huron and then paid to Morris Turnberry. So there's no, it's just a simply in and out, and that is for $2,059.39. The farmland is taxed at $3,903.18, and that is part of the expense that is offset by the rent collected. And then the portion of the airport that is operated as a municipal service is exempt from taxes. There's economic impacts to the airport. We can talk about that. That wasn't really what the report asked for. The focus was really on, is there land available to sell, and how would that work? Just a couple other features about an airport. That natural environment very much acts as a natural noise buffer. Noise is a huge problem at airports, and that acts as a natural buffer. And then of course, on the other way, it's you have Highway 86, and that help, you know, there's a larger distance, more industrial that way. So you haven't got a lot of residences being interfered by noise. And just lastly, wildlife management is another thing that we do at the airport. Having birds is a problem, or anything from coyotes to deer. Running on the runway is a challenge when you're landing a plane, you can imagine. And so we take care of it through hunting and natural enforcement and types of crops grown on the land. And if we didn't have a management plan, some airports erect a 13-foot fence along the entire length of the runway to control wildlife from crossing the runway. We haven't had to do that. We typically get reports when there are animals in the area, and we take care of it. And we have permits that allow us to do that outside of hunting season and such. So, or endangered species, we work with all of those groups. But we do have permissions to do that, because airport safety is the number one priority. That's really the summary of information I had to share for council. I'm happy to answer any questions or clarify any more information about the runway or the land.
Councilor Campbell?
Where's the helicopter pad?
Sure. So the apron of the runway is here, and that is where a helicopter would land for medevac. And they would access the driveway, come through a gated area here, and the terminal building is right next to it, where their staff wait until the ambulance drives right onto the apron.
Councilor Bailey?
Pat, can you take us back to the original picture on your study that was done? When you sent me that study, the very first picture showing all the houses and the factories.
Okay, these are the ones I have.
There's the very first one on the, forget the name of the company that did the study for
IMAG.
Us. IMAG, they showed us a picture and they had 200 houses on the south side and they had factories on the north side of it. So I'm just wondering, do you don't have that picture then?
I don't have it here. I might be able to dig it up.
No.
And bring it out.
Yeah.
That was the Novatech concept.
that you're talking about. So that's what we call that, the Novatech concept.
Just for clarification for myself, if I understand the report right, which I've read as well, that was a conceptual drawing.
Yes.
Not a reality, like that's not actually what's out there. It's just a conceptual drawing for industrial as well as air park that was being investigated. Is that correct?
It was being investigated and presented to both councils at that time, and it didn't really have any legs with it for a number of reasons. A lot of studies had to be done. A developer would have to pick that up and run with it and do all of the studies that any developer would be required to. And so we had meetings with Huron County and the two councils about that. Currently, residential is not an option on these lands.
But in the study, when I read the study, and again, I had to skip through it today because it was just one of those days. But those buildings have quite an effect on whether you're going to have 300,000 or, because you're claiming 300,000 to $5 million worth of revenue to the town. And it's based on that conceptual idea. Just hear me out, Arch. I'm not going to get into it tonight. I appreciate you bringing this forward. At the meeting you're talking about, I asked if council would see if we could at least have a conversation with it. I would still like to send it down to the economic development and have the staff and economic development work with it. There's a few things. I don't want to get into the thick of why I want to do this. We've been through it before. We're sitting in a situation where we own 220 acres in Morris Turnberry. We can build on it all we want. We get not one nickel of revenue out of it. So it's costing North Huron taxpayers, and I'm not talking about the airport, I'm talking about the land around the airport. We can't develop on it. If we were to sell that and buy land in East Wabanosh, we could take the same amount of money you're getting from this land when we rent that land out and put it towards the airport. I don't have a problem with that. But then we have land to build on, to create factories, to create jobs, to create a tax flow. Again, I'm going to ask council, I'm not going to stew on this tonight. I'm going to ask council if we could send this down to the Economic Development Committee and our staff and further what Pat has started. There's a lot of great ideas. One that came up with me, there's a few boys from Morris Turnberry said to me, you know, if we own that, we could probably develop that. After all, we bought land right across the street from it to develop. So there's many, many avenues that we could maybe take. So I do appreciate this, Pat. And again, I won't fine with it. I would just like to see council agree to send it down to the Economic Development and see what does become of it. It's too long of a conversation and to undertake it at a council meeting.
Coach Rebegal?
I've done some review of some of of the idea and looking at it. I really, from my point of view, I don't think the proposal makes any or has any logical merit. I think taking the revenue source away from the airport clearly is not a good plan, in my opinion. The revenue source does enable the airport to break even, actually make a little bit of money, although not much. There is also other revenue opportunities with regards to the natural heritage, the bush, we have been able to utilize a number of times. What I do think would have more merit and would be possibly a better use of time would be doing needs analysis in order to ascertain, you know, what are the most logical possibilities for the current industrial land that we do have. There is some within Bly. There is a little bit in Wingham left. I would suggest doing a needs assessment on that current inventory of land, which find out, you know, what sort of possibilities might be available for those parcels, and then, you know, in conjunction with that project, I would assess the average land size that we have been approached by different developers looking for. And Connie will have that statistical information as to, so, you know, over the last 10 to 20 years, here is the average parcel size they've been looking for, that's serviced. And then I think along those terms, I think then we're able to put together and formulate a long-term plan in order to deal with those, first of all, filling the industrial land that we currently have, as well as strategizing about what possibilities we need down the road and where viable parcels may be. But I don't think that selling off the part of the land that's making the money that offsets the cost of the airport is feasible at all.
Councilor Bodden?
I'm not against having this passed by the Economic Development Group.
But I'm just wondering if there isn't another showstopper here to sell land and then buy land in East Wawanosh for development. I thought that we had pretty well concluded that there's no way of servicing it without going through a $2 million plus expense of extending the services. So I think we've got to look at that before we go too far in the other direction.
Councilor Bailey?
Again, if we send it down to the Economic Development Committee, they could study all that. They could study everything you guys want to study, but I think we need to give that direction as a council, that we need to take this direction. We have no economic development land to speak of. North Urinal owns very little anyway, 1.5, 2.5 acres. Again, look at the towns around us, look at what's going on. They have put together their own industrial park. It is a big step, it is a long-term step, but that is how they're growing. So we're not inventing the wheel here, we're just saying this works, we should get on board too. We're sitting on 2 acres of land in Morris Turnberry that we can never take a nickel's tax on, never get a nickel's tax for. It's wasted land to us, and I don't see why our staff is, if we could have found that picture, you'd have seen the houses and the factories. If that's fine, let Morris Turnberry do that. It's their land. And see how we work out with that. If they come to us, we can maybe make a deal with them on something. But anyway, Mr. McGowan, I would just like to send this down to the Economic Development Committee and our staff to go through it, take the time to go through it. It's a long-term plan to come up with. They could come up and tell me that it just isn't going to work for any, and I'm satisfied with that.
Gary?
Council, just on your idea of taking it back to the Economic Development Committee, we had a meeting, I think it was last Monday or the Monday before. I know there's minutes in tonight's agenda. I know there was an initial conversation and discussion at the Economic Development Committee on your idea. I guess I'm more concerned or looking for clarification on sending this back to staff. I know staff, in particular Pat, have spent a lot of time putting the staff report together for tonight's meeting, and if there's something in the report or if there's information that's missing or questions that haven't been answered, please give us direction. I mean, there's no recommendation. We're not offering an opinion. We're providing information so that council can make an informed decision. But I guess I'm hesitant to devote more staff time to this project unless there's questions and issues that we haven't addressed. If there are, we'll go back to the drawing board and we'll provide that information. But
well, Gary, I'm fine with it. If you're suggesting to just simply send it to the Economic Development Committee, because there has been conversations with the members since then, that's fine with me. I would just like to see where we can take this.
Councilor McGowan?
In fairness, the comment keeps coming up that we're not getting any revenue on that property, and I beg to differ. I mean, the report clearly states, for 2014, we've got a budgeted amount of $92,000, so we're not getting nothing. I think it comes down to the question of whether it goes to economic development or not. It's a council decision. If this council wants to divest itself of property that is the only revenue generator for offsetting expenses at the airport, then that's fine. That's not a question the Economic Development Committee can answer. That is a council decision. And I think that the report's been pretty clearly prepared with a lot of details. I'm not sure there is anything that's really missing from it. It's pretty black and white. The airport operating expenses are what they are. The land, which is part of the discussion tonight that's being contemplated to be looked at being sold, would leave the airport with a pretty sizable deficit. And I think that council's time would be better spent looking at other opportunities in conjunction with the Economic Development Committee with other parcels of land and doing needs analysis about how to generate income out of the ones that we have currently and looking at maybe more feasible opportunities. I think, as Councilor Bodden mentioned, we do have land in East Wawanosh. There is some developmental land, I understand, in Blythe. And look at those opportunities to capitalize on those rather than spending too much time on this unless council's prepared to make that decision.
And if I may comment, I, at the last economic development meeting, I thought we beat the topic to death, and my understanding of the consensus was that we weren't interested in selling the land. So maybe you and I were at a different meeting, Councilor Bailey.
One of the members came to me and they said that why wouldn't we, if we sell the land and we lose the financing for the airport, because the airport can't sustain itself, probably never will be able to, most airports can. And then we buy the land in East Wawanosh, which is our land that we can develop, then we can take the same amount of money that we're getting from renting that land, put it back towards the airport to keep it sustainable, and then as we build on that economic piece of land and development that we have, when all of a sudden we put a building up, instead of having this little wee bit of money coming in from renting the land, we got $30,000-$40,000 coming in from a building, plus we have jobs that we've created. That's a big step once you start developing that land, and this is the conversation we had, and it's going to come before the next meeting. So we're either closed-minded and say, no, that's it, let's continue on the way we are, or we'll let some people look at all kinds of different avenues that come forward and make a decision then. But we can stay closed-minded, it's fine.
Gary?
At our last economic development committee meeting, this report had not been prepared. It was just prepared for tonight's council meeting, but perhaps at the next ECDEV committee meeting, which is scheduled for March 10th, we could make this staff report available to the committee members, and there could be a further discussion at the next meeting. Is that satisfactory?
That's satisfactory.
I think that's a good idea. I don't want us to give the committee the impression that we are closed-minded. I think we've given it a fair shot, but there may be other points that could come up that we hadn't thought of. So I'd be okay with them having another look at it and perhaps coming back with a recommendation.
We'll take that as direction. Okay, moving on then, recreation utilization statistics.
Sure. I don't know, Connie, if you want to undo me here. I'll just stay here for that report if that's okay. Or let me go back to my seat. Okay. I was asked back almost, it was actually in January 2013 when Gary and I met with staff at Morris Turnberry. They wanted to understand their grants that they give to the township for recreation and have a better understanding whether those numbers were still applicable based on how they had been set many years ago. So it's taken us till now to get the data because we had to rely on other users to provide their breakdown of their members, such as minor hockey, minor soccer, minor ball, from all of North Huron, both Blythe, Wingham, and get those numbers to be able to put this all together. So just to give you sort of a broad stroke on some of that information, and then when we came to budget, people were asking about the Dalbright soccer field. So I'm using this opportunity to share all of this information with council and just as an FYI for your information where things stand. Some general background information from 2013, just to show you some of the utilization at the Blythe Community Center and the North Huron Westcast Community Complex. So we're really pleased with the number of visits that we get at the Aquatic Center, just under 35,000 in a year. We have a number of sources of revenue, both membership, program revenue, and admissions. At the Fitness Center, we have just under 20,000 visits a year. And then we teach about 95 classes a month, and we have our strongest revenue there is membership revenue of just over 150,000. At the arenas, in a week, in the winter, there's about just under 68 hours of ice used every week at the North Huron Westcast Community Complex. 48 of that is paid rentals. Just under 16 of that is rec programs, whether that is parent and taught skate, public skating, or Huff and Puff League, or things like that that we run, hockey for fun.
Then the 2 hours are school rentals, and through our joint use agreement, they don't pay for ice as we don't pay for their gyms and fields. So we get an annual revenue of $128,000 there. The Blythe Community Center has 54 hours of ice rented each week, and 49 of that is paid, and 5 of that is our rec programs. So we're pleased with our utilization at our two facilities. The rest of this report was what was handed to the municipality of Morris Turnberry, and I'm sharing it with you today. We have two different grants that we received from Morris Turnberry for recreation, and we've enjoyed this partnership for many years, and we appreciate the grant that they do supply to us. There's no agreement formal in place, and their obligation is purely of their goodwill to help us fund recreation programs which they are aware that their residents participate in. So many years ago, it was calculated that Blythe Community Center had 12.89% of users from Morris Turnberry, so that has always been the number used. They take the budgeted deficit of the Blythe Community Center, and they pay 12.89% of that deficit. In Wingham, they pay a flat rate of $40,000 a year towards our deficit at the North Huron West Pass Community Complex. So in order for us to recreate the statistics and look at how we could calculate this, we sat down with Morris Turnberry to agree on how we would measure stats, and we designated that there are 4 types of users, large group users, as I mentioned, minor ball and such, and that was how it was all calculated before, but now we also have programs like swimming lessons and dance lessons and things that go on, hockey, day camp, that kind of stuff. We also have memberships in the North Huron West Coast Community Complex. So we are able to track where residents are coming from for all those 3 programs. The drop-in programs, we cannot track. I don't stop people at the door of public swimming, and that's kind of it. The next page is just a summary that was prepared for Morris Turnberry. Obviously, we've had another budget year-end, but this was what was provided to them to understand the deficit at the complex, and how well we're doing at the Blythe Community Center, and some of the expenses that we have in our parks, because obviously activities go on by the residents, and our residents are enjoying the ballpark, soccer field, and splash park trails, and such like that. The next set of pages are the peer data that we've collected for the Blythe Community Center. Morris Turnberry enjoys 20% utilization, and North Huron at 36% on average utilization. That's not right. Yep, that's right, sorry. Yeah, so that is, and then there's other groups that also have users coming. So this was data provided for us from the Blythe user groups. The next page is the Wingham renters that use our ballparks and hockey and all those kinds of things. And so you can see, once again, at the North Huron West Coast Community Complex, it's 20%. But it's not just the complex, it's also the ballparks and soccer fields, and 64% from North Huron. The next page is a summary of the registered programs that shows you everything from swimming lessons, how many participate, and so 17% are coming from Morris Turnberry, 46% from North Huron. And then in our membership data, 14% are from Morris Turnberry and 46% are from North Huron. So that's the report and the data that we shared. On the last page, there was also queries about the Galbraith soccer field and the cost to operate that field. Just for background, to remind council, that is a field that is located in Morris Turnberry, but has always been operated by the town of Wingham, which then became the township of North Huron, and used by Wingham Minor Soccer. Grass cutting costs are just under $6,000, and the taxes for a total of $6,200 in expenses. The revenue received from our rentals is just under $1,000. And if you go back to your report on the soccer field, it shows that in the minor soccer, 19% are coming from Morris Turnberry, and 78% of users are coming from North Huron. So after reviewing of this data, we concluded, Gary and I and the staff at Morris Turnberry, that they were paying their fair share. They were not underpaying us or overpaying us, and that we should enjoy this grant, and we recommend that we leave the operations the status quo. But of course, that's for council's discussion, and staff will do whatever you choose going forward with this data.
Questions for Pat? Counselor Campbell?
There will be soccer at the Gilbert Park this year?
Yes, as soon as I can get agreement from council that we are going to sign the agreement with Maitland Valley to rent that field again and operate it from North Huron, yes. So I'd like to get that consensus tonight that we can move forward with that agreement and arrangement, yes.
Okay, any other questions?
So Pat, you'll be bringing forward an agreement to do with Galbraith and the Conservation Authority?
Yes, as soon as if council agrees that that's the way we want to move forward on operating the Galbraith soccer field, that agreement will come forward for to be adopted as bylaw. And I would recommend, I think last time we signed it was for 3 years, and I'd like to do that as well.
Counselor Budden?
I guess I'd make a motion that we accept this report in principle as given.
Seconded by Counselor Campbell. Any discussion? Those in favor? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. Okay, next on the agenda is report from Economic Development and doors open. Connie?
Okay, as you can see, we have always in the past taken part in the doors open when the county has run that as an initiative. And they run it every other year because it's a very huge event and events happen obviously all over the county. This year is a doors open year. Rick Sickinger is actually leading it this year. He's on board as the cultural officer for the county. And this year we are looking at, it's a very, very pretty title, Rediscovering Huron, Step Into Our Stories. What we are doing is showcasing local talent and local artists on the backdrop of historical architecture. There will also be some components of looking at the importance of historical designation. So there will be some workshops included in that. At this point in time, as you can see in your report, we already have some North Huron sites on board, including the 1419 campaign with the former Blythe Public School, Memorial Hall, and the Blythe Festival. And obviously, I think this would be a very good year to showcase the Alice Monroe Reading Nook and Reading Garden, and probably highlight that as a feature property on the provincial website. So I am just looking forward. In the past, this money has always just come out of my advertising fund, and because the $500 that we give to it is directly goes to advertising locally and provincially. So that's all. Just looking.
Okay, can we get a motion to participate in the doors open, or are there questions first?
Good move. We participate.
Moved by Councillor Vaughton, seconded by Councillor McGowan. Discussion? Seeing none, we'll call the vote. Those in favor? Those opposed? Motion carried. Well, Reed Vincent has arrived, so I will vacate the chair and turn the rest of the meeting over to Reed Vincent.
Thank you, Dave. Sorry for being late. I had a meeting in Toronto that lasted a little longer than I had figured on, so that okay, Director of Public Works, Kelly, on the calcium fluoride.
Yes, I'm looking for a motion from council to partner with South Bruce here in Kinloss, North Cranberry, and Howe Township for acquire daily to supply and apply our calcium fluoride. The same price that we've been paying since 2009, actually.
I'll move.
If you read, and Councilor Campbell. Any discussion? All in favor?
Just.
James?
I would like this calcium checked to make sure it's 35%. It's just that I've had some complaints on it, and it's something that could water down, I guess. I don't know. But it's just something I think we need to keep an eye on.
Okay. Moving forward to point six. All in favor? Carry. Okay, Pat? Oh, okay. Moving to new business then. Basically, number one is information. Gary?
Just a quick point on that. As promised, Scott Tusa, the county's director of planning and development, was retained by Mark Huron and Morris Turnberry to mediate the discussion between Morris Turnberry Council and North Huron Council as it related to water sewer arrangements. As promised, Scott has submitted a report from that meeting, which summarizes the points of discussion, the common goals, the common interests of both municipalities. And Scott has also outlined his perspective and recommendations for council consideration. Going forward, I know that Scott and Nancy Mickey and myself are looking at meeting within the next couple of weeks, probably the first week in March or late next week, to discuss last week's meeting and some ideas that we'll bring back to our respective councils, and we'll go from there.
Okay, point two, petition for drainage works by the owner for a new drain. The owner is Wayne Hopper, owning part lot 42, concession 10, East Wawanosh Ward. We have to do that by motion.
Yes.
Do I have a motion? Councillor Campbell? Councillor Vaughan? Any discussion? All in favor? Oh, sorry, Dave.
Yeah, I. My copy of this was a little bit hard to read, so. Is the intent of this to dredge the drain or dredge the creek, or is it to install a drain?
It's actually both wants to register the drain of the creek as part of the drain and clean it out and add a tile. This would be quite lengthy.
Have you checked with the amount? Well, we'll do that. All in favor again? Carried. Point three, the Hullett Central Public School request for a reduction in Blythe and Luna rental fees. What is your pleasure?
I'd move that we grant this.
Vaughan and McGowan seconds. All in favor? Carried. Point four, Big Brothers, Big Sisters of North Huron, read the 2014 financial support request. What is your pleasure?
I'll move that we make the donation of $100.
Okay. Do I have a seconder? Councillor Campbell, any discussion? All in favor? Carried. Point five, elementary school fair, read 2014. Financial support request.
So,
do Counselor McGowan moves.
Same as we sponsored last year.
Same as last year. Counselor Campbell seconds. Any discussion? All in favor? Gary?
Just a note, this is one of the last school fairs that there is in Ontario.
Canada.
In Canada. Well, Ontario's still good now.
Maitland Conservation Foundation invitation to donate towards their 2014 dinner and auction, April 11th.
Can we put your rain barrels? How about some rain barrels?
Sounds good.
I mean, we can also provide some swim passes or something like that.
Okay, between the rain barrels and recreation passes, we can work that out. If there's a motion to do so.
I'll move that we donate to the Maitland Conservation Foundation. Prizes to be determined.
I will second.
And
I may have a donation to make if the publisher gets finished on time. So I'd like to make that difficult, if the timing is right.
Okay, thank you, Brock. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion? Carried. Okay. Moving to council information. Council, bring forward any points that you would like to discuss. Councilor Bailey.
On the checks on page one, we've got construction, Feldman's for construction on a SCBA station, $7,300.
So, expense authorized by your fire chief, and that's work at the halls.
I have a question about an item on page one, Blythe landfill site to $15,800. Is that an interim billing or is that for the year?
That's the final billing. We've already paid some throughout the year and that's the final.
Thank you.
Councilor Deputy Reeve Reach.
On page 10, there's Maitland Valley Conservation. Cost of laminating a post for $251.
Gary.
The Maitland Valley Conservation Authority were retained to print white copies of the conceptual plans that were developed by the University of Guelph students last fall. And these were the conceptual plans for Riverside Park along the Maitland River. And the, there were eight, correct me if I'm wrong with that, but there were eight conceptual plans developed by the students who worked in twos. And we will be bringing those conceptual plans forward at a future council meeting. And we want to develop a process to engage the community and receive input and generate discussion about these plans. So we don't have the facility here to provide copies of these large white prints, but the Maitland Valley does, and they agree to do that for a small price.
Okay. Councilor Bailey.
Page four, we have a repair here for Professor Plumbing and his repair of the rooftop unit. Just my imagination, we repair that every time.
Which facility is it? I'm sorry, I'm just catching up to where you are. Cliffs Plumbing. Repairs unit complex. Well, there's probably eight roof units on the complex, so I don't think it's, no, it's not the same one. But I can get clarity for you if you want, but on which that particular one was.
Just if it's the same one, all of that, we should be looking at it. But it's,
yeah, I'm pretty certain it's, we enjoy them all needing repairs once in a while. But I'll check for you.
Other points, or do you have something, Gary, that you'd like to put on that door?
Just item number four. A couple meetings ago, I mentioned to council that the Municipal Property Assessment Corporation, also known as MPAC, is or has partnered with nine municipalities in Ontario and created a website, an online service where voters in those municipalities could go to see if they're on the voters list. And MPAC has provided some preliminary results of the pilot project. And just to confirm, this is it's a website piloted with 9 municipal partners and 2 school boards. And the feeling is that if this website is a success, and if it generates a lot of interest, and obviously it has thus far, this site would be made available to all Ontario electors or potential electors.
Deputy Reid.
If I can comment, I went on the website and got lost and gave up in frustration.
I had the same experience. They tell me that I don't live where I live.
There you go. Are you a resident?
I
was.
I will follow up.
There are rumors about it, but.
I will follow up on that. I think right now the website is just set up for 9 municipalities, and we're not one of them.
Oh, okay.
That may be an issue.
If you want that.
I can go home tonight.
Okay. Also, Huron Federation of Agriculture annual MPP local politician meeting, the 21st of March at Clinton Legion. I will be on. I have another commitment that day, so.
I've attended this meeting the last 2 or 3 years, and it's a very worthwhile meeting, and I would attend again and thoroughly enjoy it. But if someone else would like to attend, it's certainly worthwhile. I'm going to.
Okay. So. We will be represented, and if anybody wants to talk to Dave afterwards and that they would go instead of him, that would be fine too.
Well, I'll go anyway.
Okay, that can work too. Is there any other points there that receive and file? Or is there anything else there?
So moved.
Okay. Seconder? Deputy Reid for each. All in favor? Okay. Moving to committee reports. North Huron Economic Development Advisory Committee. Met on the 10th of February, and the next meeting is 10th of March. Okay, point 2, the Maitland Valley Conservation Authority. Minutes of 2 meetings. Is there anything further or any questions?
Just a note of interest, they were going to have Family Day at the Falls Reserve on Monday. And there was over 600 people were at the Falls Reserve on Monday to celebrate Family Day. They had sleigh rides and a whole bunch of things. There was a lot more than what they could even be there.
Ready for bylaws? Okay, bylaw number 76, 2013, be a bylaw to authorize the legal clerk to execute and affix the corporate seal to authorize the agreement with the municipality Morris Turnberry to share services of Fire Education and Fire Prevention. And that was read a first and a second time, the 16th of December. Do we have third and final? Councilor Campbell, Councilor Bailey, all in favor? Carry. Number two, bylaw number 11, 2014, being a bylaw to adopt a property standards and yard maintenance bylaw enforcement policy and procedures for the Township of North Huron.
Move first, second, and third reading.
Bodden and Bailey. Any discussion? All in favor? Carry. Bylaw number 12, 2014, being a bylaw to authorize the Reeve and Clerk to sign on behalf of Council an agreement with the Knights of Columbus to operate the Columbus Center at the North Huron West Cass Community Complex. Bailey and Campbell, any discussion? All in favor? Carry. Okay. So that we have bylaw number 14 of 2014. Whereas the section of 317 of the Municipal Act 2001, SO 2001, as amended, provides that the Council of the local municipality before the adoption of estimates for the year under section 290 may pass a bylaw levying amounts on the assessment of property in the local municipality rebatable for local municipality purposes. Donna? That has it clear enough? Okay.
First, second, or third?
Reach and Bailey, any discussion? Yes.
It's not rebatable, it's rateable.
Sorry. That makes it easier to vote for.
Yep.
Okay. All in favor of the motion? Carry. Moving to council reports and inquiries. Councilor Bodden.
I've had another call late this afternoon regarding our friends the coyotes. And in this case, there are presumably two coyotes and a husky dog visiting every morning this past week at the rental place on Queens Villa, sorry, I couldn't think of the name, at Queens Villa every morning looking for food, and also down the neighboring streets. This is a lot of calls that I've had, a lot of concern, and the reactions of people are from blasé, you know, it's not, they're not dangerous, and so on, to a very deep concern. So I think that I question doing nothing at this point. And I think about what if tomorrow the unthinkable happened, somebody did get attacked. What would we do then to deal with the situation? It's easy, since we haven't had an incident, to say, well, it's not likely to happen. But if it has happened, then what would we do? Isn't that what we should be doing now, I guess, in anticipating?
Your
Worship, I don't believe this is something under the purview of our animal control officer. I don't think, why do we not contact the MNR then? It sounds like that they're frequenting the same area every day, and perhaps Kathy will give
it. Kathy, you may add something?
You are right, Archie. coyotes really aren't under our jurisdiction. I have talked to the Ministry of Natural Resources. Their resolution was to give us a package of information, which they mailed on how to handle coyotes. And our...
Get a copy?
My concern was to be passed on to a conservation officer who was to call me back, which I haven't received any phone calls. In the meantime, I have received 3 or 4 complaints too. Last Saturday morning, early in the morning, our animal control officer, who really does not do huskies, I mean dogs or huskies, but our coyotes, he attended the village of Blythe well before daybreak. He patrolled the whole village until on into the morning. His cell phone number was handed out to all those individuals that have complained. And if he is patrolling, he missed them, they were to call him, and there wasn't a sighting. I'm not saying there's no coyotes, but there wasn't a sighting on Saturday morning. The other problem that we have is the reason they are hanging around the Queen's Villa, up around on the top of Queen Street, is because people are putting out cat food, and they're not proper storing of garbage. So yeah. The coyotes are leaving the bush, they're hungry, there's lots of snow, there's nothing for them to eat, so they're coming to town because they're hungry, and people are actually encouraging them to come. So what more we can do to control them, I have no idea.
I'm wondering if we have a bit of an edge in here, that apparently the dog is joining some very bad company, and so we could report the dog and we could get some action from...
And there is a group of citizens in Blythe who have taken it upon themselves to catch that dog, that husky dog. We have a group of concerned, maybe 8 or 10 citizens that have made it their mandate to catch that husky, and so far have been unable to catch it. So I'm not sure. Coyotes are really our mandate, but I don't know what more to do. I mean,
in the absence of anybody having a mandate here or a willingness to do anything, I still have a feeling that we will be very sorry if some incident does occur.
And it's not usual for coyotes to attack people. I mean, that's not something. I've also heard that the town of Kincardine is overrun with them.
Mm-hmm. Goderich, too.
They're in many towns this spring. So I don't know what more further that we can do, but we are trying to stay on top of them.
I'll just add that if you take away the food source, they will disappear.
I've heard of people being scolded about this, and they're stopped putting out cat food and so on, and a number of places where they have decided to make their garbage more secure, but it's pretty hard to say that everybody has stopped putting out food.
Well, hopefully the press will get that message, because I know that it was south of Blythe, but there was people putting stuff out as a food source, and that they didn't realize that they were attracting the coyotes close to the village. And so that, yes, there definitely is that element in society that figure wolves and coyotes are hard done by.
Just a comment. The hunters have quit hunting them for a while because the snow was so deep, and they can't get, their dogs won't run them. So that I know that the group around have actually quit hunting now for a while. Until the snow gets to settle.
I've talked to one of the hunters, and...
Tomorrow or the next day, Jim.
Yeah.
But I think the big thing is, if there isn't a super easy food source, they will go back to the wild. Archie, did you have anything? Okay. Other, Bernie?
The last budget meeting, Don had asked me if the Wingham BIA was looking for their LED light fixtures on the main street, and I couldn't give her an answer. We had a meeting last night, an executive meeting, to put the budget together, and I've had a conversation with Kelly since then, too. I'm wondering if, since the budget's been pretty well okay, we don't want to adjust it too much, but Kelly has $10,000 set aside to look into LED, LED lighting on the main street of Wingham. I'm wondering if we could transfer that over and use that for the LED lights that the Wingham BIA is, would like to put up on the main street. It is homecoming this year, and they would like to fancy it up a bit. They have their own funding, too. They're not asking the council for any more than they're putting in themselves. They have over $10,000 set aside now to get started. I wonder how council feels about that. Or Kelly would like to speak to that.
The one thing, if you don't mind, Kelly, that I think that look at things and get a recommendation exactly what it'd be used for before we would turn it over.
It's for the Wingham LED?
Yes, but what model, what type?
Oh, it's sitting across the street. They're going to do a presentation for
yeah.
it, yes. It's just yeah. the budget rolled in a week, and the BIA didn't have their, it's their first year as a BIA, and they didn't have their budget prepared, and everything kind of snowballed on us.
Kelly, you
want to? Yeah, I had budgeted $10,000 for street lighting, mm-hmm. and it wasn't designated for any particular street lighting, like I said. So I know that there was a commitment by when they changed Josephine Street out that there was some Christmas lighting that the municipality looked after. So the money is put into street lighting. Determines what council wants to
do, or
yeah,
that was for new.
It would be nice to see the presentation before we make a decision. I guess I haven't seen the units, so I'll have to. Yeah. I would imagine they're coming fairly soon.
Well, I think Tony might be able to speak a little bit on that as well.
Excuse me, Connie.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to speak on street lighting?
I don't think so. I think Kelly's.
They want
no,
to.
No,
know
no, no.
Presentation's going to come.
Oh. Well, we can first meeting in March. We will speak on it. Or the BIA will speak on it.
Good.
Is that
there's
okay?
There's quite a few players in the
yeah.
in the street lighting. So.
Okay, other points. You ready here? Clerk Administrator's report.
Okay, thank you, Reeve. Just a reminder that Council is meeting with the Campaign 1419 committee this Thursday at 7 o'clock here in the Council Chambers. Also wanted to mention that we've been able to secure several meetings at next week's Roma Good Roads Convention. We have five meetings set up. We're meeting with the Minister of Economic Development and Trade to talk about the Wingham and Area Industrial Strategy. We're meeting with the Minister of Culture to talk about the Blythe Festival's 40th anniversary, as well as Campaign 1419. We've also received confirmation that we're meeting with the Minister of Community and Public Safety to talk about the ESTC in Blythe. We're also going to be meeting with the Parliamentary Assistant to the Minister of Natural Resources to talk about the North Huron Maitland Valley Conservation Authority University of Guelph partnership that I spoke of earlier and the conceptual plans that were developed by the graduate students at the University of Guelph. We're also going to be meeting with the Parliamentary Assistant to the Minister of Rural Affairs to talk about the Wingham Area Industrial Strategy. So those meetings will be taking place Monday and Tuesday of next week.
Brock?
Do you not have a meeting with the Ministry of Environment?
No, we were not able to secure one, unfortunately.
Has Central Huron?
I beg your pardon?
Has Central Huron made an arrangement?
Central Huron made the request on behalf of the two municipalities, but
both turned down.
There was just the one request made on behalf of Central Huron and North Huron.
Right.
And that request was denied, or he or she was jailed.
Cowards.
Okay. That's all for that?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. That for the public gallery, questions or comments, keep them exactly in relation to what has previously happened in the meeting. Okay. Comments, please. Trevor?
So, yeah, so thank you, Reed. Comment to, I think I have a comment with regards to Brock's assessment of the coyote. This is not new. Huron County's put out a requisition on the news about coyotes and what. But I think from a standpoint of mitigating risk, I think we've done what we can from a standpoint of what I'm hearing from the staff, but a comment to the ratepayers within the municipality to say, you know what, here's things that you can do to alleviate this problem. You know, that might make a lot of people sleep a little better. We're not going to stop them. There's no way to stop them. So in order to make yourself not necessarily feel better, but understand that the ratepayers need to know what they could be doing to impact the problem. And a lot of the conversation is we need to know, like, I would love to know what, like, I would love to know when you get a call or when a counselor gets a call, is when I hear a lot, that could be 100 or that could be 400. I don't know. And with a population in North Huron of 3,000, if we're making a comment on 10 conversations, I want to make sure that we're ensuring that the value is, I'm not disagreeing that that is a strong, we don't want something to happen, but we have to be careful on doing one side, we do nothing, and then all of a sudden we react and we do everything to stop it, and we can't do that either. There has to be a balance somewhere. The other comment I have, or the other question, is when we look at finances, and maybe I'll look to Donna or somebody just to explain. So when we look at gifts or donations, or when the budget is passed, if expenses get to the point where it's close to what we budgeted, or say it's gone over, what's the process from a council standpoint to understand, let's just use donations for an example. So you got $5,000 in donation budgeted. By the third month, you're at $4,800. What's the process? I just want to understand, is there a process that we know where we're at when we're making these requests? When these requests come in, does the council know where we're at with regards to the budget on those things? So that we're just not consistently saying, yes, which is, they're good ideas, but we've got to make sure we're within our budget structure.
So of course we do. We have a community partnership account set up in our budget every year. We have a standard list of community partners, some of which you've heard tonight, they've always been on the list for the last few years. And so what happens is first come, first serve. We have that standard list. There's not a whole lot of unallocated request room in that particular budget. So we have 11,800 on a consistent basis. We have 10,925 spoken for each year. So they really only have 875 room to come in. And as you said, if in the third month they have new requests that total more than 875, then they're simply out of money in that particular account. So either one of two things, they deny the request, or secondly, if it was something that council felt was absolutely imperative to the community, then they have to look to areas in their budget where they do have leeway, such as council contingency, or some of the other planning and development, if it fell under something like that. They have to find the money before they can just make that allocation.
Right, so I guess my question is that discussion isn't known by anybody here. Like, we don't, like, we see the request, but we don't know that, yes, it's budgeted for, or if it's not, like, we don't know that. Maybe that's not our point, but as a ratepayer, I want to make sure that we're not, if it's going in, if it's coming from council contingency, okay, it's coming from council contingency. I just want to, I think that communication of where money's going and how it's budgeted and what budget it's coming out of, so for an informed ratepayer, just to make sure that we keep the council and the staff accountable to that money. That's no different than, different than my home. Yeah. My wife keeps me accountable.
And it's the same, so are they. And so they always ask for that information, and when it comes forward, that's what they ask me to give them, where we're at, what's been spent, those types of things. So it's just standard practice here to do the same as what you're saying.
It happens in open council.
Yeah.
It would be an open council. It would be the only way an allocation would take place.
Right. But an open an allocation, it would come from a conversation.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the other thing is around the table, we know the ones that are the regular ones that come every year. Mm-hmm. If there was something that came up out of the blue that wasn't regular, I mean, it's an open session, as was said, and there would be a conversation about that, whether to deny it. We have denied ones in the past.
Yeah.
Or we have tried to find, if something came up that was really important, we've had to search through the button. That would all be an open process in the public domain, so.
And that's just standard practice. That's what they do every time.
Okay. Last question. I just want to clarify, Pat, when you talked about the, through you, read to Pat, when you talked about the agreement for services, for Morris Kernberry, the grant, there's no agreement in place for that grant.
There's no formal signed agreement between the municipalities for that, correct.
So, I've asked this question before. What's stopping them to say later? Like, yeah, it's money, and we're glad for it, but a contract or an agreement, whether it be in principle or whatever, gives us some type of understanding of what's secured and what's not. And I just am afraid to. Of the communications that we've had with Morris Kernberry in other agreements, I would hate for that to become leverage on something else. And that's just, I wanted to speak back to it, because it can. It's not a secret that we haven't had great relationships with regards to agreements with Morris Kernberry. And when we don't have one for utilization surface of our facilities, we're opening ourselves up to a risk.
Councilor McGowan?
First of all, I'd say that, you know, that risk is always there. Other municipalities have made donations in the past that surround us to our different recreation centers. A lot of municipalities for years have done that without agreement. That's just sort of, that's part of their regular annual donation that they do. I think it's fair to say that from what I've heard from both Pat and Gary, that Morris Kernberry sees the benefit to that donation. They see statistically, and that was part of the reason why we wanted to review those statistics, to make sure that it was a fair arrangement. They see the benefit to their ratepayers as well. Hopefully it doesn't, you know, I know there has been some talk in the past, but I don't think that that's something that's coming up in the future. We hope not anyway. If it were, the council would consider, have to contemplate whether they would be pursuing user fees or not. I don't think that's going to happen with Morris Kernberry. It sounds like they're in a good partnership with us, and they've been having good dialogue with Pat and Gary about the recreation grant, and now they've got some good statistical information that they can say to their ratepayers, like, you know, we really are, you know, this is a reasonable donation and it fits with the users. Hopefully there won't be any issues.
That's it. I just want to make that one. Okay, thank you.
I was just going to add, sorry, we'll add, there have been attempts in the past to sign a formal agreement, and we just haven't been successful in doing that, but we've always been able to enjoy their grant, so we continue to do that. And I think that if, as Councilor McGowan said, if it came to a point where we felt we needed to formalize it, we would have to do it at that time, but I think we just reform, confirming what we already are in practice.
Okay. Other questions or comments?
Yeah, Brad Carpenter. I was just wondering, this meeting investigator, why would you pay for somebody when one of the biggest operations in the country would do it for free?
You don't actually get it done for free. Things get billed back.
Okay. In soccer fields, Susan Underwood said they were building another soccer field over there. How many is that giving? Do you have any idea?
So at the Medill site, there have always been two soccer fields, mm-hmm. A full-size field and about a three-quarter field, the upper field. Mm-hmm. And then when Maitland River Elementary School was built, another full-size field was added to the complement. Mm-hmm. Their proposal is to take the small field and make it a full-size field. So there's the same number of fields, but they'll be allowed to have three full-size fields, which is making it an excellent location for tournaments and multiple games going on at the same time. Oh. So we lost Turnberry when that school closed, so Maitland River built one, and then so we have the same number of fields as we've always had. It's just now one will be hopefully a full-size field.
Okay, and you said you're renting Morris Turnberry soccer field again. Why wouldn't you just rent rooms at the school?
Not more
rooms. So how the soccer works is Effie Medill owns those three fields, which I just talked about. Mm-hmm. And through a joint use agreement with the municipality and the Board of Education. Wingham Minor Soccer can use those fields at no charge, mm-hmm. and then in exchange, the Board of Ed programs have skating on our sites and use our facilities. So there's mm-hmm. no, that's their field, they maintain it, we have no expenses or maintenance over there, and we don't rent those out. Mm-hmm. The Galbraith Field is a fourth field, and the usage of soccer requires all four fields. And so it's an additional field needed by Wingham Minor Soccer. They even also use another field at
Pentecostal.
What is it?
Oh, the Pentecostal.
Yeah, the Pentecostal Church is another field they use. So they're in short supply of fields. Mm-hmm. They could probably use five full-size fields if we had them in our community for them.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Other comments or questions? Okay, thank you. Did you mention anything about family days and how well they went?
Oh, yeah, good question. So on this weekend was our Family Funapalooza Winter Luge-a-thon, and we enjoyed some excellent participation. On Sunday, the Belgrade Community Center had over 200 attend and two bins of food collected. Participation in the programs is a donation to the North Huron Food Bank. And they had sleigh rides, campfires, and public skating going on there. On Monday, we had programs running at the Blythe Community Center and the North Huron Westcast Community Complex. And so in a small 3-hour period in North Huron, in Wingham, there were 465 people through the door for all the family day swimming and activities. And they were able to collect 4 bins of food and $223 in donations. And Blythe also had a lot of great activities. I just haven't got those stats in, but right there shows you over 665 participating with Blythe still to come in those numbers. So a great day, and I don't know if anyone was listening to the radio, they were on 101.7 to 1 all afternoon on Monday promoting our program and our facility. So it was a success overall. Enjoyed by everybody.
Okay, thank you, Pat. Okay, we're at a confirmatory bylaw. Do I have an over? Broaden and reach. All in favor?
Aye.
The next meeting will be Monday, March 3rd at 7 o'clock in the council chambers here. Do I have a mover for adjournment of the meeting? Campbell and Vaughn, all in favor? Carried.